Report. The latest situation in the war between the Orange Forces and the Blue Forces of the West is that by midnight, the invaders will have pushed forward 20 or 30 kilometres to positions somewhere roughly along this line. All day long, the Blue Forces have been falling back in a tactical withdrawal to previously prepared positions. The Orange Forces have pushed forward, meeting some opposition, although the first major battle is not expected for at least 12 hours. Earlier today, I was in the southern part of the exercise area, near the town of Einbeck, where the Orange Force was in strength in the shape of the Dutch 41st Tank Battalion. Faced by the might of the Dutch bomber, A Company of the King's Own Scottish Borderers had little option but to withdraw. One of the platoon commanders is Lieutenant
What's happening is you can hear now to the south of us, you can hear gunfire. Yeah. So our south is a bridge which has been held this morning by our A company. However, it's now been blown and the enemy now have got down to there and attacking to our people down below. They've been knocked out, right? We've been left by ourselves forward of the line. We're now going to retreat back to another location to fight the battle further back.
Within minutes, the Dutch infantry have arrived in the village. As more of them advance, a Leopard bridge layer approaches the main bridge of the village, which is out of action. Not far behind come the Leopard 2 tanks who need to cross the river as quickly as possible. While the bridge itself hasn't been blown in reality, the umpires insist that the Orange Force's Leopard bridge is laid to create a realistic time delay before the armour can move forward into the blue territory. Another progress report on the battle phase of Lionheart tomorrow. One of the features of this exercise is that 1BR Corps is using some new equipment for the first time. You may remember yesterday Mike Allen was with a rapier unit at RAF Gutterslow. Well, now the Army has a new version, tracked rapier. Pat Pashpar went to meet Hotel Sub of 11 Battery, 22 Air Defence Regiment, Royal Artillery, and spoke to Sergeant Kevin Fielding.
Kevin, you're H for Hotel Sub of 11 Battery. What does your sub actually consist of?
Well, it consists of one track rapier vehicle, which is what I'm standing in now, with a crew of three, one driver, an operator, and a tactical controller, which is myself. We also have a support vehicle, which is carries all our any needs that we might have on the exercise, as well as our spur missiles and two members of crew. Each member of the crew is trained in both pieces of equipment, so we can actually change over at any time we want to do.
Yeah, and how do you actually operate in an emergency?
We operate completely independent as a detachment. We're given an area which we cover, ourselves, and we then go on that area and give air defence to that area, independent from any other part of the battle.
Yeah. How long have you had the tracked rapier?
Well, in actual fact, the first one arrived in February, but they weren't accepted into service until the 1st of this month, 1st of September, in actual fact. And we had a large parade with the MGRA taking the salute and a large drive pass, which is quite a grand affair, really.
Yeah, well, before that, you had the towed rapier. I mean, what are the advantages of the tracked over the old one?
Well, obviously, well, the main thing is the fact that we can now travel over much rougher terrain. It's much more compact, more reliable, faster, easier to deploy, far faster to deploy, therefore giving better air defence cover.
Well, you've been 15 years a gunner, Kevin. Have you been on exercises like this before?
Well, I was on Crusader in 80, but obviously nothing as big as this. But this I think this is probably going to be the biggest one that I'll ever do.
How are your young lads reacting to it?
I think they're enjoying it. They're certainly enjoying themselves.
Right, well, we've caught up with you in the corner of a farmyard here. How have you been getting on with the local German families?
They've been marvellous. They've been really good. In fact, this morning, the caretaker's wife of the house here actually brought us breakfast, laid a table out for us. We had the old traditional German breakfast, which was very nice. Lashings of German coffee and the Wurstenbrötchen, really quite good. And of course, the children are always interested. They're always around looking, and all the locals are very interested, especially when the thing's running up, making a lot of noise, and they're obviously interested with it being such a technical-looking piece of kit.
Another new piece of equipment is Saxon, a wheeled armoured personnel carrier that can carry up to 12 soldiers in full battle kit at speeds of up to 60 miles an hour. At present, it's under trials with the King's Own Borderers. We found one disguised as a rubbish dump, and Corporal Gary Hall explains whose idea it was to disguise it in such a way.
Well, it was mine and the other two lads that were with me to do this. You know, we decided we'd camouflage it up and turn it into a rubbish heap because there's no other way we could have done it, you know, with the camouflage nets we've got. So we turned it into a giant skip, sort of.
How effective has it been?
It's very good. Even our own people have drove past us, you know, and not known where we are, even though they should know where we are. They've actually gone past us in the night time. From the river over to the east, it looks like a load of rubbish. You just can't identify it as a Saxon at all.
What's the reaction been of the locals to this?
Well, when we first did it, they laughed, and now they've got used to it. So they keep seeing us come and go and
right.
Do the same thing.
Well, now, what's your role and the role of your vehicle?
Well, the role of the vehicle at the moment is anti-aircraft with the diesel mount, which has a machine gun on top. The role of the crew when we dismount can be a number of things, ambushes, reconnaissance patrols, or just in defence, in trenches.
You have a complete section under you, do you?
Yeah, I have a 10-man section. However, now I only have the driver and the radio up with me in this role.
I gather that the vehicle's actually being tried up during the exercise.
Yeah.
What are your impressions so far?
Well, it's very good on the roads for long distance. However, on cross-country, it's a little bumpy. We've not really tried it on cross-country because we're restricted in the area to stay on tracks and most of the roads.
Now, you've served before in the track agencies, the 432s. Have you noticed any obvious advantages so far?
Well, I've seen one or two of these, you know, slightly bogged in, but they've been pulled out by another Saxon. However, you know, this still happens with track vehicles.
It looks as though you've got more room in here.
It seems to be big, but when you've got ten men in, that's six men in this half and four men up there. Commander up in the hatch there, driver at the front, radio up and two ICs sat here, and then six men fully kitted out. It's a little squashed.
Although the battle phase of Lionheart is 48 hours old, Exercise Full Flow, the bringing in of reinforcements from the UK, is still underway. And some of them, the reservists in particular, have to be given a lecture or two before they go into battle. From Senelaga Training Camp, Mike Allen reports.
All of the 4,500 reservists called up for Lionheart are processed here in Senelaga. Some like these are immediately bussed out to their units in the field, while others are kept for a few days to be trained up before being deployed. This group of 30 sapper reservists are remaining here for a couple of days to have some of their rusty army skills honed up under the watchful eye of WO2 QMSI Paul Willard of the Combat Engineer Training Centre in Hameln. But what exactly is a reservist? Paul explains.
Reservist is somebody that's been in the army, done a specified number of years of service, and has then left the service, the colour service, and gone on to what we call reserve. in England, where he's liable for military service at a certain amount of weeks per year.
So how long can he have been out of the army and still be in the reserves?
He could have been out of the army as long as 10 or 12 years in some cases.
Now, what's your specific role here with the reservists in Senalaga?
I'm here to train the sapper reservists to bring them up to standard on certain engineer tasks and skills, and then from there take them out to build a heavy girder bridge of 150 foot of length, double single reinforced over the river liner.
Are they treated exactly the same as regular soldiers or TA? Because obviously they've come from a civilian environment now. Can you just bring them straight back under strict military rule?
We can, but obviously we have to use a certain amount of leeway, so to speak. We can't treat them exactly the same as our lads. But in every other respect, they are taught or treated exactly the same.
What about things like telling them to get their hair cut?
We can't really do that because it wouldn't be feasible. But in every other respect, i.e. timing, stress, behaviour, while they're here, they're treated exactly the same as a normal soldier.
And what do the lads think of Lionheart so far?
It's a nice change from the normal run-of-the-mill home life, you know.
And what would you be doing now if you weren't out here in uniform?
I'd be working.
A week's change, chance to see some of the guys that you knew, and they were there. And get back into the swing of things.
It's been quite good, though.
Is it a bit of a shock to the system after a couple of years in Civvy Street to don the combats and having to take orders, whether you like it or not?
I thought it would have been at first, but once we actually started off, everything it's just something that you seem to never forget.
Finally, in today's Lionheart report, let's meet up with the unit from the Rimi, which Pat Pashpar discovered on his travels round the battle zone.
We're literally on a street corner near a bridge over a river. I've come across Corporal David Collett of the LED REME, who's part of 24 Brigade. Does that mean you've come from the UK, David?
That's right. We spent 4 days actually between UK and actually arrived here in sort of battle zone, so to speak.
Did you bring this beast over with you?
Yes, the army actually chartered a ferry and we all came across the vehicles as well.
Well, it's an enormous thing. What's its proper name?
It's a Centurion Armoured Recovery Vehicle.
And what's it capable of doing?
Well, basically, we provide a repair and recovery breakdown service for the heavy armour of the British Army.
Have you actually had to use it very much to do that?
Not this particular exercise, but during my past, I've used it quite a lot, yes.
Yeah. What's your actual role here today?
Well, basically, without giving too much away, the friendly forces are withdrawing through this bridge, and we're here to make sure that nothing sort of obstructs the bridge, either by breaking down or actually having an accident. If something like that would happen, we'd sort of rush forward, clear the obstruction so the traffic can keep flowing.
It's obviously very important not to get anything stuck on the bridge.
It's most vital, yes.
Yeah. While the exercise is on, David, are you and your crew living in the vehicle?
Yes, we actually live on the back decks of the vehicle itself.
Well, we haven't had the chance of looking inside, but what's it like there?
It's a bit bleak, but we make the best we can, and we're not really too bad.
Fine.
Better living in a hole in the ground.
Well, I see there's one of your team here is in his NBC kit. Can I try and have a quick word with him?
Yeah, sure.
Yeah. I'm sorry we can't put a microphone inside your suit, but can you hear me?
Yes, yeah.
I find it very difficult to hear you.
Yes, muffled, yeah.
Yes, how long do you have to have this on at a time?
Well, just while the attack is on, a little while after.
Yeah.
Until it's there.
But what about food and drink? I mean, you can't eat and drink with this on, can you?
No, only just in emergencies.
Yeah.
A couple of days.
Well, I hope you won't be in it too long. So how do you communicate with each other?
Well, we have this system of sort of signals where, like, even if I'm a few hundred yards away at a casualty and he's in the winch compartment with all the noise around him, we can still know exactly what's going on and he knows exactly what I want him to do at any given time, really.
Bit like bookies on a racetrack.
Yes, it is rather like bookies on
fine,
race
David.
Course.
I hope all goes well. I hope you won't get stuck.
OK, thanks very much.
Well, I hope you won't need a bookie to work out the odds on whether we'll be back with another Lionheart report tomorrow. But I'm sure I can tell you that it's a pretty safe bet that we will. From Mike Allen, our Director of Television, Pat Pashpar, and myself, goodbye.